Wonderful. Woke up this morning. Everything's going my way. Hope it's going your way as well. It's really going our way, actually, because we're getting more and more skillful means here. I may drink a little bit of lemonade here. I made this lemonade yesterday, and I probably put in too much cane sugar, to tell you the truth. So I don't know how many calories it has. It's got a lot, probably, from the sugar. But got on the scale this morning. I saw a beautiful number. I've been going for that number. I just got to see that number. Oh, there it was. Just like, wow. So that started the day off on the right foot. I was kind of achy and feeling sore, but I did all my stretching, exercising. I feel more limber and relaxed and feeling really good. And then to top it all off, I have this tremendous practice. I woke up early in the morning. And I began, the skillful means came into my mind. So why don't you try this? How about this? I said, okay, let me try this. Wow, what a great, great practice. So we are just set up here in a tremendous way, actually. So we're making haste slowly. We're not in too much of a hurry here. So you have to give yourself some time in terms of don't pressure yourself too much. We have the skillful means here. So we're not desperately searching around for it. We have it. So have this confidence. Have this confidence. This is very important. To abide in the court of the Dharma King means you have the confidence that the skillful means are available to us. We're not beggars. So when you talk about having faith, what does that mean? It means you have faith that you have the skillful means. You will be given the skillful means. You have the tools. You have the tools. There's a difference between someone who has all the tools to build a house and someone who has no tools at all. And they say, okay, you need to build a house. Someone has no tools. They say, how in the world am I going to do this? That's crazy. I don't have any faith I can do that. Whereas someone has all the, you know, the table saw, the chop saw, skill saw, nail guns, etc., compressor, everything. They say, of course I can build a house. Yeah, it'll take a while, but, you know, bring on the lumber. Let's get going here. And so they have faith. They have faith they can do it. They have faith that they can do it. So we have faith that we can do what? And do what? Shift our perception to clear light perception. Clear light perception. Shift to clear light perception. Shift our, make a shift to clear light perception. Shift to clear light perception. That's all. We have these Dharma kings, and we'll focus in on LOngchenpa here, who absolutely know how to get this done and are, in fact, just total absolute masters of and skillful masters of how to get this done. How do we shift to clear light perception? Jesus calls it healed perception. This is our goal, healed perception. This is the goal of all these spiritual paths and different spiritual religions, healed perception, actually. That's what it is. Same goal. They might, in Tibetan Buddhism, they might call it Rigpa or Mahamudra, or, you know, some term that is perception beyond all concepts and symbols and images and all that, direct perception, clear light perception. It's healed perception. It's all exactly the same. And all it requires is just a shift, a simple shift of attention. It's already there, as a matter of fact, but our attention isn't on it. So when we say shift, we could say shift our attention to clear light perception. Shift our attention to clear light perception. This is the goal. And so what we're doing here is practicing this. We're all about practice here. Leave all questions just as they are and shift to clear light perception. Shift your attention to clear light perception. Just leave all answers just as they are and shift your attention to clear light perception. Leave all troubles just as they are and shift your attention to clear light perception. Leave all remedies just as they are and shift your attention to clear light perception. It's raining here. Can you believe that? What is today? Is it the 21st?
Let me see.
It is the 521. It's the big 521. Wow. And guess what? We have this very skillful means today. And I'm just like, wow. Just wowing it. I've already gotten used to it this morning. It was very intense. I did one super intense session. I was lying in bed. And it was just tremendous. Best, maybe the best practice I've ever done. It's right up there. The highest echelon of just wow, this is just tremendous. Leave everything just as it is. And shift your attention, and we shift our attention to clear light perception. I shift my attention to clear light perception. Leaving everything just as it is, I shift my attention to clear light perception. Now, do not struggle to attain this. Without taking any more steps towards attainment, I shift my attention to clear light perception. Without taking any more steps towards completion, I shift my attention to clear light perception. Without taking any more steps to do anything, I shift my attention to clear light perception. Does cane sugar count as far as calories go? Does that count? I mean, it's just white sugar that counts, isn't it? Or is it both? Okay, really, just leaving my health exactly as it is, I shift my attention to clear light perception. Leaving my weight just exactly as it is, I shift my attention to clear light perception. Leaving all goals just as they are, I shift my attention to clear light perception. So we're just introducing this practice here, okay? Just introduction of this practice. We're not trying to reach a goal. Leaving all striving just as it is, this moment, without doing any more striving whatsoever, I shift my attention to clear light perception. Without striving in any way anymore, I shift my attention to clear light perception. Leaving everything just as it is this instant, I shift my attention to clear light perception. Without answering any more questions, I shift my attention to clear light perception. Without asking any more questions, I shift my attention to clear light perception. Without making any more efforts whatsoever, I shift my attention to clear light perception. Okay, we're not trying to force the shift here. What we're doing is we're introducing this practice, okay? In a 360-degree, pristine, unbelievability ambience, okay? The ambience of 360-degree, pristine, unbelievability. This is the ambience that we practice, and we practice in the ambience. Part of that ambience is the faith. Very important part is the faith that we have the tools. It's just a matter of practice and getting accustomed or preconditioning our attention, our mind, for this attention shift. We're preconditioning ourselves for this attention shift. We're not trying to do it. We're preconditioning so that it just, when it happens, will feel familiar. Say, oh yeah, I've already prepared for that, preconditioned for that. It's like in working out. You work out, work out, work out. And then I did a workout recently. I was looking at this hill I had to climb, and I said, I can do that. Well, I got halfway, and I wasn't so sure. It's like I had to rest for a while. It's like, wow. But then I looked at the rest of the hill and I said, nah, I can get there. And I did. So I preconditioned myself for confidence. You see this? We precondition ourselves for confidence in practicing. And then when we see what we need to do, we say, oh, I can do that. We have confidence. And that tips the balance in our favor. Confidence tips familiarity, confidence and with familiarity, preconditioning tips the scales in our favor. And so we're not jumping on the scale. Like, come on, I need the clear light perception. This is actually sabotage, self-sabotage. Because if we try to do it right away, okay, and we fail, we say, oh, I failed. I'm not so confident anymore. This is, you know, I don't know if I can do this. And so you start spiraling into losing your confidence We don't ever want to spiral into losing our confidence. We want to keep building upon our confidence. And we know that when we have sufficient confidence, the opportunity, the shift of our attention to clear light perception will simply take place. We say, oh, I can do this. Yeah. And then it's like, wow, I did it. There's the wow there. But we did it because we keep building our confidence. This is practice, right skillful means, right practice. And we sit quietly, committed to not doing anything, committed to probably, you know, some just baseline functionality. We're not trying to excel, because the wow of the practice will drop our cognitive and physical, you know, acuity to some extent, because we're kind of in shock. We're kind of stunned by our success. Our success stuns us. It's really stunning. It really is. You say, wow, I never knew I could practice in this way. That's amazing. Yes, it is. The world's been enamored by Tibet since these teachings were secret. Tibet was like walled off from the world for so long. These teachings were very, very secret. They're very esoteric, I mean secret. They're kept hidden, and gradually they began, some bits and pieces came out, and people were really intrigued, like, what have they been doing back there in that area for so long? You know, you hear so many tales, and so it was very intriguing through the 60s, and stuff started trickling out. People are really into it, and they threw up all these thangkas and mandalas, and if you knew a little bit, you were like really hip. You know, it's like, oh, you found some esoteric Tibetan texts. You study with a lama and they explain something to you. And so you felt really out of the loop. And if someone else knew about it, they were like really big in your mind, bigger than life. So all that somebody had to do was go over there, somehow, you know, get access to some of these translations that were coming out. I think the first one was 1959, maybe, about 65, 66, the late 60s, some translations started trickling out. You know, if they studied this, looked at it, and mastered some of the terminology and everything, then they could present themselves as some, like, incredibly spiritual giant. And all the rest of us were just, like, in awe of it. You know, they were just in awe of it. But times have changed. And that's not really possible anymore. Thank God for that. And what we've found out is, yeah, they had their own terminology, they had their own ways, their practices in it, and just as we can have our own terminology, ways, and practices, and it's actually the exact same goal. The practices are basically very similar to what we're doing, just in a simple English Western way, and we're not overawed by it anymore, and all of that, you know, has smoothed and settled out. So now here we are, just humbly and meekly doing our practice here, being supported by maybe the greatest Tibetan Buddhist ever, LoNgChenpa, who is perfectly aware that we're using skillful means. And in fact, he's helping suggest these, along with the Holy Spirit, along with Jesus Christ, Sri Sri Anandamayi, and Rama Maharshi. Rama Maharshi helped us greatly, actually, because his advice translated into English was so non-esoteric. Okay, it was so non-esoteric. Esoteric, the Tibetans had this thing called samaya, which is you don't teach anything except to those who are highly qualified to hear it. And the most transmissions are between guru or lama and the devotee disciple. And they were kept very secret. So you had all these lineages, innumerable rivers of lineages, so many, many, many. But it was all secret, and they weren't shared. Even between different lineages, it wasn't shared. It was just really secret. There's a reason for that. It helps you succeed, because you don't get pulled down by minds that are concretized and trivialized and try to throw everything into the non-abstract. So it's understandable. I have no quibble with it. In Christianity, we're supposed to share everything. Whatever we have, we share with everyone. That's a different approach, but I very much understand the Tibetan approach of samaya, in terms of if you try to share stuff with people who are highly concretized, they're going to put a spin on it. We're all engaged in mental practice nonstop. They're all engaged in mental practice, everyone. Mostly we're engaged in trying to concretize the mind, trying to script it, trying to non-abstract it, which is trying to change our mind, actually, change the nature of mind. Most are very, very assiduously engaged in this practice. And so when you engage with them and offer these great pearls of great wisdom, they immediately spin it into concretization. Well, Jesus said, don't throw your, you know, cast your pearls before swine. This is what he was saying. So Christianity does have somewhat of a tradition of don't, but I of course, in miracles says that you got to give everything to everyone, So I just share everything to everyone, and I'm not trying to violate Samaya or anything like that. I'm not in a formal, well, I'm in a relationship with LOngchenpa. Yeah, so he can correct me if need be. But I tend to be someone who shares everything with everybody. But I do have some, I do realize practically I don't say much to anybody because I realize they're not able to process it. They'll spin it in the wrong way. But here it's so selective. I'm not forcing anyone to watch the videos. So if they want to watch, they can. If they don't, they don't. But in personal relationships, you're talking with somebody that, you know, there's kind of a, you know, a trap. I mean, you're kind of in a situation there where you're forced into relating with one another, and they may feel like if you're taking advantage of them, if you try to talk about some of this stuff like this, and it'll shock them and frighten them. Actually, it does frighten them. I've noticed that if you share too much, it frightens them very badly. So I just avoid saying anything, really. So the idea that the it's the end of the age of these big gurus that overawe us, yeah, it's the end of the age of those who pretty much who deceive us through having some esoteric knowledge that just, and we feel like we're just completely in the dark. It's certainly the end of that age, no question about it. But it is the age of these great Dharma kings contacting us and working directly with us, because we're no longer overawed by the whole thing. You see that? So that's actually way, way better. We've left behind the age of these, there were these number of gurus and teachers that were just, we just, you know, just like, were just floored by them, because, you know, they had this, you know, hip lingo. They could say this, and they could say this, and they could say this, and this, and they're just like, clever deceivers, you might say. Wikipedia has helped out a lot, actually, and some websites on the web who are explaining this information, and I've been digging into it, and I thank everybody who's helped clue me into the importance of this. So the potential to be overawed now for me is evaporating. And so I just let it evaporate. I don't try to measure it, but I can tell that era is coming to a close. And it won't be coming back anytime soon, fortunately for us. So we're now disposed and free to just simply practice like this and not worry about getting overawed by all this stuff. If we need to take a look at something, we can take a look at it and say, okay, I see what that's about. And say, oh, yeah, it's very similar to what we're doing. Like, I look at, like, Talopa, and I say, oh, this is, I mean, he had this full stop in the wild practice way back then. What was that, 9th, 10th century, 11th century, something like that. And very much so. We have our own style of doing it, which is just as valid as his style of doing it. All right, just as his was just as valid as this style. You see? So we're not overawed at all. I got this from the Holy Spirit. He got his from, you know, maybe Vajra Yogini or something, or Vajra something. Well, that's fine. It's an aspect of the Holy Spirit. Same thing. We don't need the big shot gurus, you know, anymore. We have direct access to the great Dharma kings, actually. So that, you know, that age is I see it's come to an end, you know, and we just have to, you know, put some flowers on the grave and thank them, because in some ways it was very helpful. It was very challenging. Not to be crushed by him, really. And it kind of demanded that we get very tough and very dedicated. And I'm still working on it. I'll do my homework, keep doing my homework, absolutely. Recently I came across something. It was quite extraordinary. Just, you know, very, very important information that's very, very well known over in the esoteric circles, India and Tibet and wherever. But here we just have not really, it's, you know, it's anything that seems vague and mysterious and esoteric and exotic and profound, and you know, it's like we're kind of like, wow, a kind of insecurity kind of creeps in, like maybe there's something important I don't know. Now, full stop in the wow is the key practice. You know that you have the tools you need. Managing your success on the path is the key practice. There isn't any other more profound practice. This is the key practice. Everything else is subsumed under this full stop in the wow. And this is really the root, I mean, of the Sarma traditions, Talopa's, you know, the six keys, is full stop in the wow, is what it really is. The Sarma is the more modern three branches of Tibetan Buddhism. And again, Tibetan Buddhism became all the rage back in the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s. It's still going on to some extent, because of the esoteric hidden aspect of it, because they were so dedicated to it and had so much success. It's the favorite child, favorite son. People are intrigued by it. You know, you see a llama or something, I guess people, and people's legs turn to jello. It's like, oh, their hearts are flutter. It's like, oh my gosh, well, you know, they have some sort of secret knowledge. Now listen, if you know how to practice full stop on the wow, you know, you can hang out with LOngchenpa. That's what I do. I hang out with LOngchenpa. And I'm not, my heart is not all flutter. I mean, I have gratitude, great gratitude, devotion, gratitude, love, and wowness, basically. I just have wowness, sure. But I know how to manage the wowness. And if you're hanging out with a Lama or Rinpoche or Tulku or something, sure, there'll be wowness there. I mean, all respect to them and honor for their efforts. And so you have to manage the wowness there too. I would do the same. But as LOngchenpa said, when, if you're going to have a song, why not have the one who can sing it best sing it, so everybody else can get used to it, you know, and reinforce it in the most profound way. This is what he said when he was invited. There was this area with so many, many lamas and high spiritual beings. They were asking for teachings, and he came, he arrived there, and there was all these teachings be going out, and he said, hey, wait a minute, listen, let me just tell you, I'm the Dharma holder of all these teachings, and so let me sing this song, because you'll hear it most clearly, and it'll make the biggest impact on you, and I can sing it over and over, and it'll really reinforce, and everybody agreed to this. They said, yeah, that's the right way to do it. So if you can hang out, might as well hang out with LOngchenpa or Jesus Christ, Sri Sri Anandamayi Maharaj Maharshi, hang out with them. Might as well. You know, you're going to have to manage the wow anyway. Might as well get the ones who sing it most clearly so you, you know, really get the opportunity to keep practicing the wow and really advance very quickly. And LoNgChenpa must have brought in Vajrayogini to, who, the Dakini is the action aspect of grace, where they're able to offer up certain skillful means that it's helpful if they're the ones who introduce it. Okay, there are certain skillful means. And this is all very abstract, okay? And if your mind is abstract, you won't have any trouble with it. But if your mind is concretized, you know, you're just going to not get anywhere. So you have to, your mind has to keep practicing shifting to abstraction, away from concretization. Leave all questions unanswered and shift your attention to clear light perception. Hey, actually, it's kind of rainy. Yeah, there's some precipitation. It's just very... They said it would. Leave all questions unasked. No more questions. Leave all the rest of... Whatever questions you've asked, fine. But leave all other questions unasked. Set aside all your asking and shift your attention to clear light perception. Set aside all your efforts of acquiring and shift your attention to clear light perception right now. A clear light perception is seeing directly without, you're not seeing reflected light. You're seeing with the light of the mind, not the light of the sun. You might put it, let's put it this way. You're not seeing with the light of the sun and sensory perceptions. You're seeing with the light of the mind and mental perception. That's clear light perception. And that's very close to knowing. It's still perception. It's not knowing yet, but that's the highest we can attain here is healed perception. Clear light perception. So, in a lot of ways, the all this esoteric information came out. It devastated us in a lot of ways. But we may be able to bounce back from it, I'm hoping. It caused a lot of negativity towards gurus and teachers and stuff because of the exploitation that happened. And so there's this very negative attitude that built up, unfortunately. A very bad situation. Hopefully we can realize, okay, that's the bad, but the good aspect of it is now we have a grounded approach now. We're not overawed, and we can actually benefit from just this overall ecumenical situation in the world right now, where we realize it's all very simple, actually. It's just shift our attention to clear light perception. That's all. That's all it is. And you have the Dharma King like LoNgChenpa saying, yeah, that's all it is. That's all it is. He, you know, the pinnacle of Buddhist and Tibetan Buddhist sophistication, you might say, pinnacle of it, is saying, oh, no, it's completely simple. Just shift your attention to clear light perception. That's all there is to it, actually. May 21st. we're not ignorant. We're not naive. We're headed towards event horizon here. There's no question about it. It's an attempt to concretize all of our minds. This is the great danger, because truth can never be seen in a concretized way. That's an attempt to change mind, change reality. Concretization is really futility. But we can wander in the desert of futility for a long, long, long while, really, and just suffer, and engage in all sorts of foolish activities designed to remedy the suffering, sacrificial activities and stuff like that, which have no avail whatsoever. And just really lose our dignity to such a terrible extent, really, and have such a hard time finding our way back home, that we don't want to get pulled in that direction. Okay, we have to say no to that. There has to be a no to something. Okay, there has to be a no to something. If you say there's no at all, then it's enslavement. Who's saying that you can't say no to something? So what is it we say no to? We say no to concretization, the attempts to pull our mind into concretization. That is the baseline. If we don't say no to that, then we're lost and enslaved into self-delusion. So for those who say we have no right to say no to that, they're saying we have no rights at all, actually, none, and that they have the right to demand we suffer. That's what they're saying. We can't say no to suffering. We have no right to say no to suffering. Oh, yes, we do have the right. This is the arrogance that they say. You have no right to say no to arrogance. What do you mean? I have a God-given right to say no to arrogance. And they refuse to acknowledge that. This is the trouble we have right now. Big trouble here. It used to be you had the right to repent. Absolutely. And we were encouraged to repent. Now, there were still attempts to control your repentance, etc., of course, but you were encouraged to be meek and humble and repent. Nowadays, it's the opposite. You're encouraged to be arrogant. Now, is it arrogant to say, well, I'm hanging out with LongChenpa? No, because is it arrogant to set down arrogance? If it's arrogant to set down arrogance, we are truly lost forever, right? But it's not arrogant. That saying it's arrogant to set down arrogance is itself arrogance. Whereas saying it's not arrogant to set down arrogance is not arrogant. So if we just have this complete relativism, then we're lost. We're lost in arrogance. There's no way out if that's the stance we insist on taking. And, you know, it's kind of like a power play. There are those that are insisting that we have no choice but to take that stance. Or you should feel guilty if you don't take it. And they try to use guilt against you. And so we just have to be determined to keep practicing and ask the Holy Spirit to remove these blocks and pressures upon us. What they say, well, if we're all arrogant, then it's not arrogant, right? This is their magic solution. So they think they're working on the solution of arrogance. If we're all arrogant, so there's no, that must be what's normal, what God wants. Now, even if we're all arrogant, it's not what God wants. God doesn't want us to suffer from arrogance. That's the real suffering. Believing that we're separate from God, that we're not as God created us, that we're not free, that we're concretized, all of this is terrible suffering. God doesn't want that for us. What God does is he reminds us that we're free. We're free to set this down if we don't like it. And God will never stop reminding us that we're free. So this attempt to say that we're all arrogant, then that's our safety, our refuge, is not true. Because God is still within us, we're still of God. And God will never stop reminding us that we're free. So that will bother us. We will cause anxiety. Absolutely it will. So this attempt to make all of us arrogant is really driving us down into anxiety and from there into depression. So they're really saying everyone has to be severely depressed. Well, having been there and done that, I can say no to that, absolutely no to that. And yet people still insist that's what we must do. So really, very... don't even need a word for it, do we? Wow, it's a very wowish situation. Wow. This is exactly what's happening. People are really, now if you don't know this, you'll just kind of go along with it. You're not really sure what to say. But if you know exactly what they're demanding of you, which is severe depression, and having, if you've been through it like I have, then it's just wow. That's pretty scary. But that is what is being demanded of us, severe depression. And from this severe depression, then is being demanded of us that we enslave ourselves to despotism, to try and you know, quote unquote, cure the depression, which is just more structure. Less freedom, more structure. This is what we're being, they're telling us we have to accept this. Well, we call guru power, okay? We empower all Dharma kings, and we empower all great helpers of the Dharma kings. All empowerments and all permissions to protect the Dharma in our minds, to protect our spiritual momentum, protect us from depression, protect us from concretization, protect us from these demands, give us refuge from these demands. We absolutely must empower this with the most intense determination. Now, I have this because I've been through it. I know exactly what it's all about. So, if you might be a little, you know, depression, you know, anxiety, I'm not sure. I know, I'm sure how terrible it can be. It can be so terrible you cannot believe how terrible, beyond belief, really. So, I'm adamant about this. If you go down that path of towards depression, you will regret that to the utmost dregs of regret. And you just won't believe, you know, how stupid it was to do that. And you'll never do it again. You swear you'll never ever do it again. You will never ever do it again. So then you have to make good on that promise to yourself. And get very serious about the path. So if you have suffered really badly, you know exactly what was being shared here. And the ego, that's what the ego demands of us all. Perpetual severe depression with no way out of it. The ego really wants to get us out of the way, right? It's spirit scares ego. Freedom scares ego. Truth, reality scares the ego. The ego just wants us incapacitated. And what do you have then? You just got like a living death, basically. And the ego says, oh, well, at least I feel a little safer now. Yeah. That's all we get out of it. Because the ego claims it feels safer. But what's the feeling we actually have? Like a living death. There's no happiness we're having. Just a plausibility. You know, the ego says, well, it's plausible that I might feel okay now. But we don't feel okay. So if we want to live on the bread of plausibility, you know, that's a bad, bad way to go. So leaving all plausibility just as it is, we shift our attention to clear light perception. Leaving all plausibility just as it is, we shift our attention to clear light perception. Leaving the entire field of plausibility just as it is, right now, just as it is right now, we shift our attention to clear light perception. The 360-degree pristine clear light perception. And we're just getting used to this. We're introducing this. We're conditioning our expectations. Condition our expectations. Now, these pseudo-gurus that exploited our naivete, you know, let them go, and don't kick them on the way out, you know, just because in some ways they were helpful, all right, and it was part of our life. It was, we also kind of were interested in the exotic, and of course, they exploited that for sure, but we thought we could get something out of it. So just let it all evaporate away. Don't be mean-spirited. Take the high road. Give it all the benefit. Give the past the benefit of the doubt. Okay? We just give it the benefit of the doubt. Don't go back to it. Don't go back to it. The exotic, the esoteric, that's all now in the, that's in the past. When you're young, you tend to be vulnerable to that, right? Looking for the exotic. I was looking for some exotic island or something. You know, you don't know what's there. Humanity, you know, you just have, nobody knows. So it's like, it's this adventure. You don't know what you're going to discover there. The creatures, the inhabitants, the ways, all these things, like, you know, like the anthropologist, social anthropology, go into these back jungles and they don't know what they're going to find back there. It was all very romantic, spiritual romanticism. So maybe there's some monastery way back in the Himalayas, you know, just up on in a cliff, and, you know, and below there's a valley, Shambhala is there, and you're, I got to find out what's there. It's just you know, you're curious. You're seeking, you got a curiosity and excitement. It's very exciting, spiritual, romantic. That, you know, that's finished. Let it go. Let it just drift down the river. What we're interested in is actual shifting our attention to the clear light, 360 degree pristine clear light perception. That's actually what we're interested in here. And we're not really interested in anything other than that. And we have the practices to do this. And we're making haste slowly. We're not trying to force anything. We're accepting it. I'm already there. Why do I need to force it? I'm already there. I already have it. Now, apparently, we're being helped by this, the highest of all, high Dakinis or Vajra Yogini, the Mother Tantra principle, and if there's some practices that are suggested from that, and I'll test them out and see. Some aversion training and stuff. Okay, we get a little of that taste, not a little of it. We're getting the taste of what some of these esoteric practices. Nobody's supposed to say anything about it. Well, some of it may just be this aversion thing. Well, I've already done it. And I say, okay, that's very helpful, very effective, great. It's not a problem, but it doesn't supplant our full stop in the wow practice at all. Because when I do a little bit of that practice, I say wow, so I'm right back in familiar territory. Well, we don't leave the familiar ground of our practice here, and the terminology, we don't leave it. We still have it. And it's helpful to get some of these, maybe these practices from the highest Dakini of all. Isn't that great? I mean, isn't that wow? I mean, let's spend some time just wowing that. Because this really helps us a lot. It keeps us from being overawed by all these other approaches. And then there's, God knows, there may be wandering the world. There may be some who try to hook you into being overawed. And if we can just get used to this, that we've gotten like a key technique from the highest of all, the mother of all Buddhas, you could say, who only introduces these into a situation that is ripe for it. And it's been introduced here. This is just tremendous, tremendously helpful. A lot of wow to this. And again, but all you need to do is practice this wow. Just say, okay, full stop in the wow. Don't try to go forward. Don't try to go backwards. Don't try to go sideways. It's very simple. Don't try to grasp it. Don't try to recall it. Don't try to increase it. Don't try to decrease it. Don't try to think about it. Just got to be in this neutral zone. Not really thinking any thoughts one way or the other. It's kind of a full stop in the neutral zone. I'm not really going to do anything about it, one way or the other. Neither accept it, neither approve it, nor reject it. Neither approving nor rejecting. Neither advancing nor retreating. Neither approving nor rejecting. Neither planning nor adding. Neither adding nor subtracting. Neither organizing, scheming, planning, hoping, wishing, desiring. Leave all of that aside for the moment and just wow. The whole landscape just shifted on me. Wow. If the whole landscape shifts on us, what should we think? No, nothing. Don't do anything. Just keep your awareness and just realize it's going to take a little while for my awareness to adjust to this. That's all. So I'm not going to try and do anything at this point. Vajrayogini has showed up and given us some of her key effective practice that she has given out to some of the Mahasiddhas, some of the great Rinpo Lamas and gurus and masters throughout history. Wow, that really is a landscape shifter, isn't it? So, we don't need to run to some some teachers, what does this mean? What does this mean? Some, you know, we say no. What we're grounded in is wow. What it means to us is wow. You see? So I'm not running. I'm not trying to find some Tibetan Buddhist center and go find some tulku or something. That says, hey, Vajrayogini showed up to you. You know, what should I do? What should I do? No, I'm just saying wow. I got this practice. These practices. Wow, that's really cool. That's really great. Wow. That's really a big wow. But I say, I can handle this wow. I know how to practice this wow. So I just do it. It's just determination. Just do it. Just do it. So if you just get better and better at full stop in the wow and really commit yourself to this, you'll find out that you don't feel like you need to go begging. Because there's a type of yoga called dream yoga, actually. It's one of, I think, Naropa's six yogas, dream yoga. It's very, very commonly known in Eastern traditions. And you could say I might have done dream yoga without even labeling it that. Stuff arises in dreams for me. I have contacts in dreams. Make connections in dreams. I've had profound dreams recently. Very profound. Very profound. And when I wake up early in the morning, a practice will come into my mind. I ask for a practice and there it is. So you might call this dream yoga of some sort. But we don't really call it that here. I mean, because that tries to pull us into classifications. I'm not really into all these classifications that the Easterns used. Three of this and five of this and three of this or three of that and five and six, nine of this, you know. I'm not really into that. They structured it all because they were dealing with a very wide, large area, so many people, and that's understandable. Sure, if you're going to really be spreading it or far and wide, you might put some structure in because people are desperate for structure. What we really want, we here, we want to keep it very abstract. It's just wow. And this is the strength of like Chan Buddhism and Zen Buddhism, is they tend to keep it simpler, you might say. What did Bodhidharma say? What is the Dharma? Moo, or something like that. Yeah, wow. they keep it more abstract, at least somewhat. It also gets, there's some esotericism to it, but you try to keep it abstract, away from all the structuring. That's better, actually, because you could easily get hooked on, your mind can get hooked on all, learning all this structure. That's why LoNgChenpa says, stay away from the graduated approaches, just wow it. Stay away from the graduated approaches. You get lost in the structure, and what you're going for is shifting your attention to the completely abstract, clear light perception. Shifting to clear light perception. It's that simple. There's nothing else to do. So the step we need to take is just as simple can be. There's nothing else we need to do. I wonder if that rattlesnake on the path was also symbolized. It's a multivalent symbol, a very powerful symbol. Symbolized those gurus in the past that shocked and awed us with their so-called esoteric knowledge and all that, and their facility with it. Like a rattlesnake's rattle, it stuns you temporarily. Now, I was not that stunned. I never heard it before, but something in my mind told me, that's probably a rattlesnake. What? Because it doesn't sound anything like anything I've ever heard. I mean, it's so unique, and it's just like, I couldn't think of what, like, it's not a bird, it's not an animal, what could it possibly be? I said, it's probably a rattlesnake, wow. So I stopped and I stepped back. And I was thinking, maybe I should go, no, I'm not going to go look in the bush. And I said, what do? I don't know what to do exactly here. But so I just gathered my nerves, gathered my thoughts, and there's a bicyclist that rode past just at that moment, a young man. I don't know, maybe he was like 13, 12 or 13, something like that, on a bike. And he just whizzed right through. And when he did that, it kind of broke the spell. I said, wow, if he can go right through like that, maybe I can. So maybe that was sent, divine grace that was sent to me to calm me down. I said, I still have to get past this path, but what if the rattlesnake is lying in wait, coiled up to strike? So maybe this rattlesnake symbolizes all this esoteric overawedness of all this strange sound, strange noise, strange teaching, exotic teachings that kind of unnerve us. So I gathered my nerves and suddenly I just leapt across the bush area. I sprang like a big, like a broad jump across, like really fast. And I was on the other side. Ah, wow, I'm safe now. So maybe it symbolized that. All of this esoteric, these spiritual traditions in history, in the coming out of the mists of ancient civilizations, all this kind of stuff, is kind of like so exotic and esoteric. It's like the sound of a rattlesnake. It really shakes us up, unnerves us, and we temporarily become very vulnerable to not thinking very clearly. Like I was thinking, maybe I'd better go find out what that is. That's what came to my mind. I was so unnerved. Maybe I better go find out what that is. And I said, wait a minute. I says, whatever it is what it is, okay? Do I really need to go find out what it is? No. It's like, what am I, you know, an ornithologist? I'm just some kind of exotic bird. I said, I think I'm going to ask people I meet, you know, there's probably a better way than me poking around that bush to get a read on what that might be. So I think I'll be a little careful about it. Because whatever it is, it's probably not too, it didn't sound like it was too happy that I was there. Like it was kind of like warning me off, like, you know, hey, don't mess with me. Don't mess with me, this is dangerous, this is something dangerous, don't mess with me. So I said, no, okay, all right, let's just get past this and then we'll think about from there, from once we get past it, then we'll consider, you know, other stuff. And so I looked up on YouTube, sound rattlesnake makes the son of a gun. That was exactly it. So I said, okay, now I know. So I was patient. I said, okay, let's not. And this very much parallels these gurus that came out of the woodwork, out of learning some of this, getting a quick familiarity with esotericism, Tibetan esotericism and Mahamudra and Mahasiddha esotericism and all that. Is I said, wow. This seems like kind of dangerous. I think I'm going to find some way to get past this and then look at it back in hindsight. But we may have made some bad choices temporarily because we were kind of unnerved by it all. And underlying all of this exoticism was this sort of veiled hint, veiled hint. They always sort of veiled hint that if you really commit to the guru and what they're, you know, selling you and doing, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, and make a lot of progress, you turn out to be, you know, really, really great at it. If you really turn your life and money and everything over to them, and if they show that you're totally loyal to them, they'll introduce the hidden Dakini practice, hidden secret practice. And of course it's always sexual tantra that they're holding out this possibility, and that they have some quote unquote great Dakinis or these consorts there that will practice with you. Or if you're a female, it's the other way around too. They, if you're female, the guru themselves will be act the role of the spiritual consort in these secret sexual tantra practices that will give you the great bliss. You know, bring you a way to achieve this great, you know, bliss. That's the whispers you hear. It might be something like that. In summer, actually, you know, might be, and yeah. So they structure like this. This is the carrot that, you know, they're holding out. And you know, if you're a young person, you might be like, wow, this is pretty interesting, you know. That's what happened. That's the past. We're not holding anything out like that. No sex, no drugs, no rock and roll at all. Just full stop in the wild. That's it. Just shifted your attention to clear light perception. And interesting, this is like the mother tantra, mother class of focusing on brilliance and clarity and spaciousness and all that. Whereas the father approach is more using anger. I don't know what they call it, but it has to do with focusing on bliss, trying to get to bliss. Keep in mind, Ramaharshi said that bliss is not really the goal. It's the great stillness. It's the great silence. Okay, that's higher. That's better. So, and Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma also focused on the great bliss. If people called bliss, you'd say, oh, there's something, the silence, the great bliss. But it's more the great spaciousness, the great silence, the great peace, the great calm. Someone asked Ramaharshi back in the day, you know, there's all these gurus around. How do I choose one? And he says, very simple. Choose the one that you feel peace around. When you're around them, you feel peace. Okay, that's the way to choose a teacher. That's the way to choose a teacher. You feel peace. And you certainly, Ram Maharshi, that's what you feel. And our Dharma kings, that's what you feel. Jesus, what? The Prince of Peace. The Prince of Peace. Not the Prince of Bliss. Okay. Prince of Peace. So I was never oriented so much towards bliss, but most of the Western societies, you know, the way we took spiritual teachings was more the Father way of bliss, that sort of path. They just turned father, mother, just as archetypal sort of labels. It doesn't mean male and female really at all, because great majority of women are towards the Father way of bliss, especially now. They're, in fact, they're the leaders of that. They're rabid about it. Fanatical. And they see you, if you're a man, as just a spiritual consort for them to engage in all sorts of attempts to get bliss. So for me, I'm not into that at all. My approach is the mother approach of clarity and spaciousness and peace and stillness and ineffableness. Abidance, an absolute stillness and tranquility, just this effortless abidance, absolute clarity. So in this, there's no call for spiritual consorts, really. And there's no reason to try and mix the different approaches. What does that get you? Just muddies the water. If you're trying to clarify the water, don't try to mix it up. That's stupid. So the quote-unquote father approach uses a lot of sex, drugs, rock and roll, all this kind of stuff, and all these tantric practices that are designed to generate bliss, and you know, all these, it seems very exotic and exciting to young people. But generally, this is, you have to be very cautious about that approach, to say the least. And the way that approach was used, always within a context of spiritual community, Sangha, three jewels, the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha, the guru, the practice, and the community. It has to be done in that context with many safeguards and with very advanced teachers, and you have to be predisposed to that. And I certainly don't advise it, unless you're absolutely cut out for it. But if you are, you know, whoopee, good. It doesn't mean that the other way is any less at all. In fact, Ramana says it's higher. The great silence, the great tranquility, the great stillness, the great peace. He says that's further than bliss. He goes, go, don't get stuck on the bliss. Don't get stuck on the bliss. So what we're doing is here, we're not even aiming for the bliss, actually. What's the point of that? So it can be done through that bliss way if everything is predisposed to that. But certainly in our materialistic culture, etc., I would say it's not advisable. I don't advise it. And if you want someone else to advise it, you got to go to someone else. I'm not going to advise it. I mean, here we have Vajrayogini advising, you know, the pus exercise of seeing all flesh as just pus bags. Yeah, that's going to steer you away from any of that bliss practice, that is for sure. See the whole world that way. This really gets us out of our egoic perception and helps us shift into clear light perception, 360-degree pristine clear light perception. So ecumenical doesn't mean mixing these two fundamentally different approaches. It doesn't mean that at all. What it means is within a certain approach, recognize that this same approach has been used throughout all the different traditions. Most definitely, Jesus Christ certainly uses this clear peace, clear light peace approach. And the other approach, you have some of the Mahasiddhas and the Sahaja approach, the crazy wisdom approach, that kind of approach. Okay, that's a distinct approach, and we're not interested in mixing up with that at all. It's not needed. It's not advised in the slightest bit. Let them do their approach. We'll do our approach. Our approach. It is a guarantee of the highest attainment. So we're not insecure about it at all. And it's those who are trying to attain bliss that are, I find them, those are the ones that are insecure about their approach, and therefore they feel they need to kind of try and seduce you into their approach to try and deal with their insecurity. All we're doing is just full stop in the wow here. That's it. We're not insecure. We know this is going to work. So why do we need to do something different? We don't. And any criticism of it is insecurity. There's a lot of insecurity on the other path, that's to say the least. Now, it's supposed to be a faster path. Of course, when you're young, you're in a hurry. You want to get to the bliss fast because you're suffering from depression. Of course, you want to get out of it right away. But what I found is it's the blissful approaches themselves that led to the depression. Is you try to stack up too much positivity. You're just stacking up positivity. You're not really committed to super positivity. Because super positivity is really the peace. And so the Holy Spirit told me, look, it'll take you a while to get out of this depression. You just have to work at it. And that just steady, determined work is what will succeed, which is what Ramaharshi says. Steady, determined perseverance is what succeeds. Whereas the others say, Shaktipat, boom, go right into the bliss. Spiritual concert, boom. Tantric practices, boom. Sexual tantra practice, boom. Use drugs, boom, and use desire to transmute desire, and it's all very pyrotechnical and all this kind of stuff, which is, and you think, oh, I'm just bored, uninspired, poor, schmuck, schlepping along here, just not really with it, Well, no, that's not true at all. Just the opposite. All those pyrotechnics are. Now we're not completely stayed and I put out these videos recently from time to time of these just spectacularly beautiful artistic videos. Sure, because we're not against beauty, of course not. The mind is completely beautiful, but make sure we put it in the right context here. So we just wow it. We're calm. We're peaceful. We wow it and appreciate it. Just take it in. Wow, that's beautiful. And this is kind of like a fire break. So we're not tempted by all the pyrotechnics, the fundamental pyrotechnical approach. We say, well, occasionally we could take a look at we got our own pyrotechnics in the right context. But that's not fundamentally our approach. So I do this on purpose. Because so we don't get seduced into the pyrotechnical approach. And we say, oh, yeah, I could. It's kind of like they're about ready to light a forest fire, and it's going to be this blazing inferno. Okay. And we're thinking, wow, that would be really kind of amazing and exotic and romantic to go, go fight that fire or go to that, watch that fire or, something, be engaged with that fire. And so we think, yeah, maybe I'm just kind of like not really adventurous enough or something, right? And that's why that starts working on your psyche. Well, so I'll make a video and you know, it'll be just really like a small little controlled forest fire. And it's circumscribed and we understand. I use LOngchenpa and he seems to lend himself beautifully to this, ideally to this. It's really quite extraordinary. I cannot explain it. I've tried using Jesus, Ramana, and Sri Sri, Anandamayi, and it just doesn't work at all. But if I put LOngchenpa like in those flower frames, it absolutely just is a knockout, for me at least. I just say it's perfect. So use it, I use it. If it works, use it. And so I'll make this little controlled forest fire and we get to see this bonfire or something blazing. And we're like, we kind of get the feel like, wow. Okay, that's what a wildfire's like. Okay, yeah. And so then when we're invited to the big bonfire, the vanities, you know, we just say, I don't need that. Kind of been there and done that. I know what that's about. I don't really need that. I'm not really interested in that. I've got something way better to be interested in, which is shifting my attention to 360-degree pristine clear light perception. Yeah. And we're right there. We're right there. We're not going to change horses in the middle of the stream. I mean, we're almost across the stream. We're not going to change horses. So, but yeah, I know what that is. What we'd say is, well, yeah, maybe sometime, but not now. So that's the way to do it. You just say, oh yeah, that's really cool, but I'm not going to do that right now, but maybe some other time I might watch some huge bonfire of the vanities. Yeah, it might be cool at some point, but not right now. So it takes the edge of this intrigue off of it. Takes the edge of intrigue and adventurousness and all that stuff off of the exotic, esoteric, how they, you know, use all their props, etc., the circus that they put on. You know, it's a very exciting circus that they put on. Takes the edge of excitement off of it for us. We say, yeah, I can always, I know what that's about. I can always look at this if I need some beauty or something. And we've got you know, if they throw up some sex goddess or Dakini or something that's for the pyrotactical approach or something, which they do a lot of, which will be coming on a lot. I say, well, I can always look at Sri Sri and Anandamayi and just, wow. That's beyond exotic. You know, it's really no words. You can't really describe it. The confidence, you know, you talk about, if they try to hook us with female confidence, which they will do and are doing right now, you just go to the ultimate confidence, female confidence ever, which is Sri Sri Anandamayi. There's never been a female body, but she wasn't a female body, she was spirit, but Vajrayogini herself, the Purna Brahma Narayana, the perfect confidence. There's no way anyone can be better than that. In terms of absolute poise and confidence. Just stunning, completely stunning. So we have access to that. If we need that. If we need it. But we may not even need it. This is a question I have of how much to make that available. Because I certainly don't want to tip people towards this female confidence that's coming, which is designed to really first hook us and then ultimately loop us back into concretization. We had the fake male gurus. Okay, what's coming now is the fake female gurus. That's what's coming. And that's worrisome. You know, it's worrisome enough to me that I'm just doing everything possible to prepare for it. I don't even know if it's going to be enough. I just have faith that it will. So, yeah, that's the trouble that's coming. Is we had the fake male gurus, many of them, and that really knocked knocked us for a loop for quite some time. Now we're finally getting past that, but here comes the fake female gurus now, who will blend all the lingo, the exotic, and the love, devotion, the heart. They'll try to blend it all into this, you know, just this very potent brew, actually. And we can say, well, we got our own brew here. Thanks. But maybe later I'll drink that brew. We have our own brew here. There's nothing more powerful than like Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma or our Dharma Kings Ram Maharshi. There's nothing better than that. And since we already have that, you know, to turn away from that, is what's the point of it? You know, maybe later I'll consider that just as an adventure. But I'm not really into that type of adventure. I'm into the adventure of succeeding right now, to shifting my attention to 360-degree pristine, clear light perception. That's what I'm into right now. And in I already have the tools to do it. The house is almost built. I'm not going to go work on some other house. Now I'm going to finish this one, and then maybe later I'll go work on that other house, but not right now. But yeah, most of the world is going to be swept away, you would think, by these fake female gurus. Fake is I don't know what word to use. The end game is dualism, okay, is to avoid clear light perception. That's their end game. So you might say false, ultimately false. They may seem to be very, very powerful and compelling. But the end game is ultimately keeping us addicted to arrogance. And all of arrogance, the flesh, the body, the world. You know, let's build more hospitals, you know, healthcare. Ultimately, it loops us back into all of that. It's a distraction. They're trying to take our true commitment to realization, make it seem like they have it, and then gradually turn us away, turn us back to the world. But first they have to engage with us where it seems like, you know, oh yeah, they're all for our enlightenment, but really they're turning us back to the world. So that's, you know, exactly what we don't want right now. So again, be very careful here, and don't unequivocally shut yourself off from it, because that will cause you to stumble and fall. Because in the back of your mind, there's still some temptation. Okay, so you have to acknowledge that. That's why I say you need to be humble and meek. Acknowledge the temptation and say, well, you know, I'm committed to the Dharma Kings. I'm committed to the core of the Dharma Kings right now. And if they want to release me from this commitment, okay, you know, but right now I'm going to stick with this, and maybe later, if they release me from my commitment, or I decide I want to end the commitment, but certainly not right now. And I'm committed enough, so I'd have to ask them if they advise me to be released from my commitment to their courts here, and it's like that. And I trust them that they'll act in my best interest. So I'm not going to make a unilateral, unequivocal decision right now. Right now, I trust in the direction I'm going enough that I'll say I'm not going to do it now, but maybe later I might engage in it. I can't promise I will or I won't. I can say it's possible. So don't, you know, work it like that. Work it like that, because otherwise they are clever enough. They're very clever. The egoic mind is very clever. And they're clever enough to trap you in they'll praise you. Oh, wow, that's really great. And they'll keep praising you and keep praising you and keep praising you and put you on a pedestal of like, look how committed you are. You're so great. So can I be your student? Oh, this is awesome. I never knew I'd met somebody like that. And then it becomes evident. They start, wow, you know, I thought you were a great teacher. And it shows that you're not really truly committed. Wow, you're kind of a fake. And then they try to push you off the pedestal. And they say, wait a minute, I won't push you off the pedestal, but you have to commit to me, to my path, and to me as being your teacher. And they flip the script upside down on you like that way. So you can do not get put into a position of being a teacher. Like I say, I'm a Dharma prince, but that's all I am. Okay? I'm committed to being a Dharma prince. That's it. For this lifetime, I will continue to be a Dharma prince in the foreseeable future. And, you know, later, you know, that it's possible I could change at some point, but not right now. So humility and meekness is extremely important for us. But not false humility, okay? Not because they'll trap you that way too. The ego's very clever. So if I say, well, I'm just nothing, no, I mean, I know that, then they'll say, oh, I really like your humility, this is great, I want to hang out with you. And then they start saying, hey, wait a minute, you know, you're way better than that. You weren't being honest, you know, with me. Why are you trying to trick me? And they'll start, you know, getting guilt trips on you and everything. So for me, I just say, LOngchenpa said, why don't you just look at yourself as a Dharma prince? I say, well, I'll consider that. So yeah, I say I'm a Dharma prince, but that's all I am. That's all I am. Even if I'm abiding in the 360-degree pristine, clear light perception, I'm still a Dharma prince. Maybe become a more and more respected one, but still a Dharma prince. Okay, not a Dharma king. No. Absolutely not. I serve in the court. At the pleasure of the Dharma kings, at their behest. If they ask me something, you know, I'll listen to it and consider it, absolutely, as I have done. But no, just a Dharma prince, that's all. But I'm happy with that right now. I'm not trying to go for anything more than that. I'm just stabilized on abidance in clear 360-degree pristine spirit. You know, clear light perception. Now, many spiritual teachers that may come out of the woodwork in the future might be working for these goddess teachers, these false female teachers who are trying to loop us back ultimately into concretization. This is what I've already been aware of. They've already come out of the woodwork and let me know of their presence, that, you know, that's, they're really working for these female gurus, and they're trying to hook me into joining them by acting as if they're going to be my students, so to speak. I said, whoa, what do you mean students? Well, I'm just a Dharma prince here. I'm just pointing others to the Dharma kings is all I'm doing. I'm not a quote-unquote Dharma king teacher, no. I'm just advising everyone do this self-practice, full stop, and the wow. That's all. But what they do is first they try to get you to be their teacher, and then they're your students, and then as they start trying to reveal some of your insecurities or insufficiencies or whatever, they say, "Well, you're really great, but you know, I'm also a student of this teacher over here." And she's like really amazing. You gotta, you know, maybe you should check her out. This is what they do. This is classic. It's like drug pushers, the same thing. They have got people working for them, drug addicts working for them. And you'll tell them, no, I don't use drugs. They say, oh, really? That's great. Yeah, I really want to be that way too. And so they'll align with you as if they're really seeing you as some really great example. And then gradually they say, hey, you know, these drugs are not that bad. You know, I think maybe you're being a little too strict. And they try to seduce you and then say, well, I know someone actually has this really good stuff. You should try it. This is exactly what they do. You know, they're seducers. They're saboteurs, actually. So here, we just practice full stop in the wow. That's what we practice. And we have some skillful means that lead to the wow, you know. But we practice full stop on the wow, and I'm very competent in that. So I'm very competent. I'm competent enough. So you know, nobody can say, "Well, you don't know what you're talking about," or maybe someone else can. No, I'm perfectly competent. It is a very simple practice. It's so simple that it's not like I'm messing it up or something at all. So if someone's not doing it right, it's because it's on them. You know, they're not dedicated, they're not committed enough to it. They've got their eye on something else. Really. It's very simple. Just sit here quietly. Just be still, quiet, and let your mind just be in neutral mode, and just don't let it engage with anything when you're in the wow. It's just dedication and patience, right? It's a patience out that comes out of dedication and confidence. It's actually a practice that comes from tremendous confidence. I have tremendous faith in the Dharma Kings. They've proven it to me in so many ways. I have tremendous faith in them. So this is what they advise to do. I have confidence that they're right in the, what they're advising me to do. So it really is a practice of tremendous confidence. So if those have trouble, they're just lacking confidence in it. And if they claim they have some teacher that's so great, and yet they're lacking confidence in this all-important practice, that just doesn't add up at all, does it? And if they say, well, they're so much better than you are at practicing, I say, I don't think so. The Dharma Kings don't tell me that. LongChenpa says I'm a Dharma Prince, which means he's basically telling me that I'm competent to give out this practice. And if he's happy, you know, I'm happy. Okay? That's how it works. If he says I'm doing good, I don't need to do better. Really, I mean, I don't need to abandon the court of the Dharma King for some other court. You know, what is that? Keep in mind, all politics is spiritual politics. The whole world, everything is all mind training. Everything's mind training. Television is mind training. Movies are mind training. Music is mind training. Politics is mind training. Sports is mind training. Everything is mind training. Everything, all politics is spiritual. All mind training is spiritual in that it's involved with our spirit. It's all that way. So it's always been that way. And there are always tremendous efforts to control us and prevent us from getting free of arrogance. Arrogance is always trying to prevent us from getting free of arrogance. That's what arrogance does. It says you don't have a right to get free of arrogance. That is the root of arrogance. If we felt we had a right to get free of arrogance, we would get free of it. So arrogance tries to exercise its pretend authority over God by saying we don't have any right or capability to get free of arrogance. And that if we do, we're supposed to like do it right this instant, or else it proves that we don't, or do it faster. And we say no, all it proves is that we have a continuity fear. Okay, so this is the key to getting free of arrogance, is saying, look, my only problem is the continuity problem. So we have all the right practices here. It's just a question of doing it. It's a question of confidence in doing it. The only problem I have is a continuity problem. There is no other problem. I don't have a world problem. I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem I have. There is no other problem. The vision of oneness, the shifting of attention, shifting of my attention to a 360-degree pristine, clear light perception is the cure, only cure there is for the continuity problem. See, this is a very powerful practice. I just got hit by the wow there. Again, don't use drugs, don't use caffeine, because the buzz that caffeine gives you is very similar buzz to the wow. And so you won't know, be able to determine whether you've reached a wow or not. Well, if you're really buzzed on some drug, you'll say, no, I just feel a buzz all the time. So I must be making great progress because I'm always buzzed. No, you're on drugs. But if you're not on the caffeine or drugs, you suddenly feel this buzz. Something similar like a caffeine buzz or something. It's just like, wow, the intensity suddenly skyrockets in your nervous system. It's just like, wow, there's the wow. And then you see it, you catch it. Immediately you catch it. And then you slow down. You start coasting at that point. Now, we gain confidence in the practices by having success in the practices. There's no other way. We don't get it through the teacher, so to speak, so much. We get it through the Dharma kings also, but not through the Dharma prince. The Dharma prince is just suggesting do these practices and proving to yourself you can do it. So what we do here is we prove to ourselves that we can do it. Okay? So we gain this inner confidence in ourselves. We're not... See, this is what is key to our approach, is we gain this inner confidence in ourselves, our capacity to do it. It's like running up a mountain or a hill. I did it. And when doing that, I said, wow, I did it. I can do this. So again and again and again in my life, I have taken up a challenge and said, let me try to do this and let me succeed, and then I'll prove to myself I can do this. And this builds an inner confidence. Now, it's very helpful for us that our teachers are not even here in the flesh. So the idea of associating them is not possible in the flesh. So we then are compelled to prove to ourselves that we can do these practices. So when we actually practice and say, wow, I did the practice. It's like dieting. What are you going to do, pay somebody to diet for you? And say, oh, that proves to me that dieting is possible. This is a very, very sketchy approach to do it that way. Extremely sketchy. And we're into the safe way. I know when you're young or if you're very adventurous, you might love the sketchy stuff, okay? But at some point you come to regret that very severely. We're not into using your youth against you here. We're trying to speak to the wisdom within you, realizing, hey, you know, someday I won't have this youthfulness, and I better be grounded in what really works for me. I better use this youthfulness to prove to me I can do this basic, the really profound practice that actually work, and I can keep using that all the way through my life. And I better do that instead of going with these sketchy approaches. What are you going to do, pay someone to sleep for you? A lot of you have got sleep deprivation. You say, I'm going to pay somebody to sleep for me. Do we get the refreshment from paying someone else to sleep for us? Really, is that possible? We're going to pay someone else to eat for us? Gee, I'm hungry. What do I do? I'll pay somebody to eat for me. This is a very sketchy approach. If you're hungry, you got to eat for yourself. If you're sleepy, you got to sleep for yourself. So we need to practice and prove to ourselves we can do this. And the more we prove to ourselves we can do this, the less dependent we are on the sketchy approaches. I'll say, maybe later I'll try something really sketchy. But right now I'm seeing that I'm gaining confidence. The more confidence we gain, the more we recognize, hey, this really works. This is actually going to work. And that's a big wow. Where the sketchy approaches, the appeal to them is that they might not work. That's actually the appeal. In other words, our continuity fear is being used against us by these false teachers. They're not telling us what our real problem is. Our problem, the root of practice that I start out with, is the continuity fear practice. I do not have an insecurity problem. I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem there is. Therefore, the insecurity problem doesn't even exist for me. Only 360 degree pristine, only shifting my perception into 360 degree pristine clear light perception abidance cures my continuity fear. It's the only cure there is. There's only one cure, and that's all there is. But this absolutely cures it. The more we practice this, the continuity fear practice, the more it knocks out all this sketchy approaches that really rely on our continuity fear, our desire to fail, actually. It relies on our desire to fail out of fear of the continuity fear. So say, I don't have a fear of failure. I don't have a fear of success. I have a continuity fear. The continuity fear is the only fear that I have, the only problem I have. There isn't any other problem. Therefore, fear of success doesn't really exist for me. only the continuity fear exists for me. Shifting my perceptual attention to 360-degree pristine, clear light perception abidance is the only cure there is for a continuity problem. I have one problem, and the shifting of perception to clear light perception is the only resolution to this problem there is. There is no other resolution. There is no other resolution to it. This is, you might say, the base practice, which is very essential. It's been a while since I've practiced it because I've already done it, so it's enabled me to add on to this. This is engaging with our continuity fear in the right way instead of denying that we have it. The false teachers will try to make you feel ashamed that you have this continuity fear because they act like, well, I don't have a continuity. What are you talking about? You know, and you feel so lowly and inferior to them because you have this terrible fear of success. And they say, well, I'm successful. Well, why about you're so afraid of success? Come on, let's get with it. And you say, oh, I got such fear of success. And then they'll use that fear of success against you by presenting something, a very sketchy approach that's supposed to work really fast. And you'll get into that sketchiness of that and overlook the wow, the continuity fear, the wow, all this stuff. You say, oh, no, I'm going to get success real fast. And then you become, all the problems arise from that and the wheels come off. So you say, no, if they try to make you feel inadequate, you say, well, yes, I have a very severe problem. In our path, the path of full stop and the wow, walking together in the wow here, in the courts of the Dharma kings, we first thing we do is admit, I have a very severe problem, extremely severe problem. I have a very severe fear of success. But what this really is I have just, but it's the only problem I have. It's a continuity problem. It's an extremely severe problem. So I have to go at it very carefully and patiently and gradually evaporate this fear. So I have to be very dedicated to this gradual evaporation of the continuity fear. But it's the only problem that I have. I don't have any other problem whatsoever. And the only resolution to this only problem I have is shifting my perception, leaving everything just as it is, and shift my perception to 360-degree pristine, pure light perception abidance. Okay, that's the only resolution to this one problem I have. I have one problem and one resolution. That's all there is to it. And if you get hit up by these teachers, these false teachers, don't even try to show them how great you are at getting free of them. No, realize, just say, well, I'm not going to really try to show them how tough I am. So you just say, not right now. Maybe later I'll turn the tables on, but not right now. Okay? Do it that way. Be humble and meek. Just walk away from them. Just say, maybe later. Just say, hey, maybe I'm, just say, I'm just not, I'm not great enough for you, you know. I mean, you know, you deserve great students. I'm just not great enough for you, I guess. You know, just, maybe I'm not great enough for you. That's okay. And yeah, maybe I'm just not into it as much as you want. And just walk away. Because you already know what your problem is. And you know it's very severe. And this has to be looked at seriously. Serious and safe. You have to take the serious and safe approach. It'd be, you know, they may say, oh, you're a tortoise. Oh, well, I can make you be more of a hare. Don't worry. Here in this approach, we combine the tortoise and the hare. Okay. We combine the two. We go very fast. But then when the wow comes, we coast. We coast. So I was in a store with a guy who really reminded me of one of these powerful false teachers, very famous, powerful false teacher. in the 70s, 80s, and 90s, mostly. And I said, wow, he's just like the splitting image. I mean, holy cow. Same attitude, everything. And I kept looking at him. I kept thinking, how can I let him know that he can't fool me? And all of a sudden I decided I'm not going to say anything. And I just realized I've got the capability of walking away from him, but I'm not going to brag about it, okay? So I didn't say anything. That's the right approach. And again, in your mind, you say, well, right now I could walk away from that. Maybe later I might engage with it, so just let it be what it is. Let me just let it pass. Let it pass by. Just let it pass by. And maybe Vajrayogini will give us a practice. If we ask her, she'll probably give us one that'll help us out with this. That's, you know, kind of an aversion treatment. Now, you don't want aversion treatment unless you realize the situation is drastically dangerous for you. You've got to, then aversion. You know, if you're an alcoholic and you realize if you drink again, you're going to die. Well, you know what? You're going to want aversion treatment at that point. And so this lure to back to false teachers, especially the female teachers that are coming, you know, that's drastically dangerous for us. Drastically. So I'm certainly open to aversion training. I met some guy yesterday. I was waiting in line, and he just said, well, how's your weekend going to go? I said, I don't know. I'm just going to take it easy. My mind's able to keep itself very focused, and I'll be able to do something really great for my mind. And I said, what are you going to do? He says, I was going to go fishing, but the water's too rough. It's too rough, actually, he says. He says, he's really mad about it. He said, doggone it. He says, I got this new lure. He's like some expert fisherman. He told me, there's this new lure out. It's a light lure, he says. And it's like, it's got these fake anchovies on it, and some light that, it's a lure with some, like maybe it's an LED light that shines on the anchovies and makes them glitter and flash. And he says, you troll that through, and they says the salmon can't resist. They just can't resist. He says, it's an awesome lure. He says, there's another one, too, that works. But I think they're using these underwater, you know, LED lights now on the lures, okay, fishing lures. And they said the fish just can't resist. Very interesting, huh? And I just said, what he's telling me is very important, but I didn't realize what it was until just right now. And as we're getting into this time now where the allure, it was going to be so strong that even the very, you know, wise salmon may be attracted to this lure. And this is what Jesus told us, that the allurement that will happen in the end of this cycle, which we're in right now, we're going to enter it, I say May 27th, we're really going to enter into the end of this cycle, so to speak. We're going to feel it, start really feeling the allurement now that's present. That even the wise, you know, the ones with a lot of experience will be tempted to be lured into the jaws of, be hooked by these very alluring hookers, spiritual hookers, false spiritual hookers, who are themselves working for the reptilians, which is working for this cosmic corporate culture of more concretization, more arrogance, basically, more arrogance. Their solution is not less arrogance, but more arrogance. Not letting go of arrogance, but making it even greater. You know, they think, what do you mean? We more arrogance is the answer. That's what they're really working for. And they're very clever and very alluring, actually. They're so alluring that Vajrayogini herself has showed up. That means she's saying, you know, time for me to, you know, slam the door on that. She knows the means to prevent us being trapped by allurement. Not that LoNgChenpa doesn't, but coming from a Dakini, Vajrayogini, it carries some extra weight, doesn't it? And we'll, you know, says, hey, there's this very nasty allurement coming, and I want to shut the door on that. Let's get some aversion to that. And it's, it, you know, I accepted it. I took her hand. Said, okay, yeah, okay, let's do this. Takes a lot of confidence and maturity to do that, because if you're young, you might still be interested in sketchiness and danger, right? There's something about young people love danger, don't they? I never loved danger that much. It's to some extent, sure. But in the back of my mind, I said, I've got some limits to this. I flirted with that. I went through a phase where I decided I'd see what that's all about, and I got into a dangerous phase. So occasionally I had some phases of that. But in the back of my mind, I say, no, this is just temporary. I'm going to back away from this at some point. Of course, we all think that, don't we? And that's how we get trapped. It can be. So I'm aware of what that's like, flirting with danger. But some people are too much into it. So I tend to be more conservative that way. When we talk about conservativeness, it means, hey, I'm not really into flirting with danger right now. Maybe later. And those who are really into flirting with danger, you might call them, you know, non-conservatives. Because they think, hey, you know, let's try this. In other words, let's flirt with really severe danger. And this is fun. This is adventurous. But no, I submit to everyone that shifting our attention into clear light perception, that's the real adventurousness. And it's not dangerous, but it's total, it opens the door to all adventure. The adventure of glory, the sublime adventure of God's glory. That's what it opens the door on. And in this dangerousness, and avoiding shifting and keeping our concretized perception, it's our lack of adventurousness which causes us to keep searching for adventure, I mean for danger, to make this entrappedness seem like it's really adventurous, when it's really not. It's really not. It's really incredible boredom. So we try to fight this boredom with all sorts of endangerment stuff, you know. This is what's really going on. So I try to remind all of us through some of these videos, the beautiful artistic ones, that we're going towards glory here, the adventure of glory, when we shift our attention to clear light perception and away from danger, endangerment. We're going to true adventurousness, not this fake adventurousness here in the world of danger, endangerment. That's just fake. That's just posturing, just posing. We're not into danger. We're not into sketchy stuff. But we still have that, you know, habit within us to greater, lesser extent. And so we have to be aware of that we can be attracted towards the big wildfire, you know. But I'm less and less attracted to that. It's a discipline. I don't watch the news at all. So that's a great step forward. I don't pay attention to what's going on in the world. Because really, it's all stories. What are the stories about in the world? Endangerment. Are they not? Oh, someone was hurt, harmed, endangered, killed. You know, all these people were killed here. They died here because they were trying to do this and they got caught. It's all about this play of endangerment. Is it not? More or less, right? The planet's so endangered. We're all so endangered. No, the only endangerment we have is to get attracted to endangerment. The only problem we have is the continuity problem. There isn't any other problem. I don't have any other problem. No one has any other problem. It's the only problem. We all have the exact same problem. Continuity problem. And the more we evaporate that, the less attracted we are to endangerment. I'm just not attracted to it very much anymore. You know, so I don't pay any attention to the news. I don't watch the news. All these stories are non-stories to me. Because we break it down, it's endangerment, pretty much so. And, you know, they throw some fluff in there. But and even the way that the people are dressing now, presenting themselves, and it's generally... They're saying, "Hey, I'm danger." You know, I just saw this. I saw this there's this like magazine lying somewhere on the ground, and it was like, oh, there's some picture, there's some woman picture, some model. Gee, big surprise, right? A magazine with a model in it. And I just, right, peripherally, I just saw it, and I just said, oh, that's danger. What is she presenting? Femme fatale, danger, danger, I'm dangerous. And yet this is like held up as like, this is what we do here in this world. You know, we engage with danger. I said, what? That's crazy. Why would I want to engage with someone like that? A femme fatale. That's crazy. You're just headed towards endangerment and suffering. And death. What in the world? And yet this is what the world is presenting to us constantly. I mean, magazines are just awful. Unfortunately, people still look at them. I tell people, whatever you do, don't look at magazines. I absolutely don't look at magazines. The Holy Spirit just reminded me there, there's that one brief instant of why I don't look at them. So, ah, okay, femme fatale. So everybody's dressing these days like they're really dangerous. Like, hey, I'm really, and that's alluring. It's so alluring. And look at this tattoo. I'm so dangerous. Look at this tattoo I have. It shows something like I'm, you know, dangerous. You know, skulls or whatever. All these tattoos that are just saying, hey, engaging with me, you're engaging with danger. And that's so, it's like irresistible to all these people. Really. They say, oh yeah, you're dangerous. I'm dangerous too. Look at my tattoos. Ooh, you got a tattoo of a black widow on you. Oh wow, that's so sexy. I'm so wow, it's great. It's so alluring, you know. This is what they're doing. This is because they're bored out of their minds with concretization, because they're not experiencing the sublime, ineffable glory of reality. They're not looking with a clear light, perceiving with clear light perception, and they're just absolutely bored, and they think that there's no way that they can ever change this or get free of it. So they're trying to simulate fake adventurousness through endangerment. Like, oh, this is so intense. Whereas we look at some sublime, like these flower frames, it's sort of echoes of the sublime with LOngchenpa there. It for me, it's just like, wow. If I let myself experience, I feel like a faint, it's like jasmine on the evening breeze. Just a faint, what is that? Oh, that's jasmine. And I know somewhere in the distance there's some jasmine vines, you know, a wall of jasmine flowers. And if I went over to them, oh, I'd really experience, you know, this fragrance. It's like that. So we're getting this hint of the sublime here and reminding ourselves of the ineffable glory of reality. The 360-degree ineffableness of it all. So what do we need endangerment for? It's ridiculous. We realize we don't have to keep faking that we're some swashbuckling pirate adventurers, you know, wenching our way through our lives, you know. We don't need to pretend like that. Well, it's ridiculous. Being so endangered, like, ooh, you look like you're dangerous. Ah, I am. Wow, you know. Let's engage in this dangerous death dance together and pretend that we're really super adventurous, when in fact we're scared out of our skulls about true adventurousness, because we have this incredibly severe continuity problem and we don't even know how to deal with it. So let us pretend that ignorance is bliss here and engage in this dance of danger together. Wow. And let's call it spiritual consortism, you know. Let's throw some spiritual labels and fluff on it all, make it seem like it's all legit, you know. This is like, let's help it seem like this really is adventurous. Wow, you know, when it's not at all. The only, you know, getting back to the sublime, ineffable, clear light perception of it all is, that's what's really adventurous. Because that's showing that you are confident that you can handle the sublime, that you can full stop in the wow if it gets too much, right? And that you're committed to true adventurousness of reality, the glory, Jesus says, the indescribable glory of reality. He says you just cannot imagine it, really, you cannot. That's real adventurousness. So this discipline and this patience with these practices, that's coming from someone who's really adventurous, truly adventurous. Now, like I said, I come from a family of adventurers, but that was adventuring in the world. I said, I want to be really adventurous. I want to get back to reality, back to clear light perception, because that's what's really adventurous. And my dad, being one of the world's great adventurers, at the end of his life, he came back and told me, he says, hey, it's not where it's at. It's not where it's at. Go within, he said. Go within. That's the real adventure. Man, I took his advice. I took his advice. Because if anyone would know, if world adventure is where it's at, he would know. He would know. He went everywhere. I mean, he just, you know, if there's some dramatic, wonderful place, he was there. You know, hiking, you know, you meet him at the top of Mount Fuji. Literally. Watching the sunrise in Mount Fuji, there he is. And then next day he's off to the cherry blossoms. And the next day he's off to, you know, the hot springs in Hokkaido, the monkeys. And the next day he's, you know, he's back to India, you know. like that. Seriously. Like that. So he was always going to some place that was supposedly sublime in the world. And it, you know, he told me, no. He says, no, didn't find it. It's not there. You won't find it. You won't find it by doing that. So I said, thank you very much. So it's a great help. My dad's a great help. Was a great help. Not just to me, but to the world, actually. He was told when he was younger by some great pundit, astrologer pundit, that he was going to be some great world, new spirituality leader of the new spirituality in the world. That was his destiny. So he thought he was really had something great to do. But in the end, he said, no, you got to go within. That's where it's at. And so, amazingly enough, he turns out to be one of the progenitors of profound spirituality, because he helped me out so much. And I'm certainly working on genuine adventurousness here, which is really the only spirituality there is. And I've certainly worked and gone within. And he was certainly very helpful in that. Gave me a great foundation, not only with all the books and library and talks and everything, but also with his final, you know, deathbed advice, so to speak. Although he himself was not entirely committed to it. He was wise enough to advise me. Yeah, it's kind of like that. It's somebody who has some bad habits, and they tell you, look, don't do what I did. That's a mistake. That doesn't mean they're free of it, but it means that they have the spiritual grace to advise you, you know. So, we didn't end on the best of terms, because I was trying to heal him, and he thought I was nuts. He said, what are you doing? You know, I'm dying, I'm leaving. I said, oh, you don't have to, actually. You can ask Jesus, grace of Jesus, to help you see it's just all pretense, you know, just completely pretense. You don't have to. But he thought I was kind of nuts, because he hadn't gone within in that way. But he certainly knew enough to say, you're not going to find it out there. He just wasn't sure what in here exactly was, you see. So when I tried to tell him what was in there, he was like, you're crazy, stay away from me. At least I tried, though, you know, at least I tried. I had to try. I wasn't just going to let him go without at least trying. But yeah, he didn't really appreciate that. Hopefully someday he'll understand that. Yeah, of course I'm going to give it a try. That's what I do. I don't give up on people. I never give up. I never give up. I never accept death as I never accept that we have a death sentence hanging over, that we're bound to death at all. I never accept that. I don't accept that for anyone. I don't accept that for myself or anyone else. Now, if this body happens to pass away, okay, it happens to pass away. But I don't accept that as an inevitability at all. It just means that you know that was what I chose. But it was just a choice. Yeah. Jesus says usually most of us would choose that way, but he says we don't have to. No, we don't have to. And ultimately you can just turn the body into light if you want to. You don't have to give the body over to death at all. Death is just a pretense. So, yeah, I don't hold that against him. He was kind of upset with me at the very end. Because I look at, you know, I understand that, and I look at all the great positivity that he gave, the great super positivity that really he was pointing towards, you know, saying, hey. And so I said, yeah, that's where it's really at. But he was prone to mistakes of the, you know, the false guru syndrome, of false adventurousness, false positivity, you know, facility with esoteric terminology and all that kind of stuff. He spoke Sanskrit. I mean, that's he went to Stanford on a PhD program and to learn, and was learning Eastern religions and stuff in Sanskrit, so he could play the role of some guru, really. So he learned Sanskrit. Could speak it, could read it, you know, everything. So that was like a big wow for all the, you know, the gopi gurus, gopi groupies. You know, it is a great raconteur, spiritual raconteur, and all this kind of stuff. But that enabled him to play the role of a fake guru, really. And I just saw, you know, I just, you know, just ignored him, basically, yeah, for a long time. And he eventually came back and said, wow, that's not it. That's terrible. Actually, it was really terrible for him. Very bad. Very bad. But, yeah, you better be careful. You know, don't go around spouting a bunch of Sanskrit. That's not necessary. And don't go around chanting in Tibetan. That's not necessary. I know they say it is. It's not. That's an ego trip. That's a spiritual ego trip. Unless you're Tibetan, of course, then it's not. Or unless you're, you know, you're in Hindu and you're really into it, then it's not necessary. It could be, but it's not necessarily at all. But come on, I mean, we're Westerners, you know, what we're going on doing, well, I got to do all the chants in Tibetan. I mean, come on, that's an spiritual ego trip. We just say, I have an extremely severe problem, but it's the only problem I have. I don't have any other problem. Continuity fear problem is the only problem I have. I have no other problem whatsoever. None. So this, you know, despair problem doesn't exist for me. I don't have it. The continuity problem is the only problem I have, and the only solution to the continuity problem is shifting my perception to clear light perception. That's it. Just say that. That's just as powerful as Om Mani Padme Om, Om Mani Padme Om, Om Mani Padme Om. Just as powerful, if not more powerful, actually. Now, it's true, the Easterners were very much into mantras, mantra yoga, yantra, mantra. Sri Sri Anandamayi recognized that and gave him a lot of sankirtan of chanting Ram 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 Haribol 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 Hey Bhagavan Hey Bhagavan. She called it sankirtana, and the use of the name, chanting the name. She said it's like extremely powerful and effective. So, well, there's lots of extremely powerful and effective ways, actually. In fact, vast numbers. And this continuity fear practice, just saying it, is an extremely powerful and effective way. It's no less than chanting the name, okay? And so we don't need to learn Sanskrit and chant the name. If we feel it, then that's fine. Sometimes I do that. Ramana, 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 Ramana. If I'm feeling gratitude towards Rama Maharshi and I want to express the gratitude, I can do that if it's a profound experience for me, sure. But I don't lose sight of our continuity fear practice and our just wowing it, our wow practice, no. I'm confident this is as good a practice as any practice there's ever been in the world. Absolutely. So, I don't feel any need to go learn Sanskrit. Or learn the Tibetan language. They say, well, it's easy. Well, of course, these posers, well, the first thing they'll do is, it's like, how can I wow people and they think I'm some awesome guru? I'm going to learn Tibetan. You know, I'm going to learn the syllables and read it And I said, oh, I have this esoteric text. It's only in Tibetan, but I'm able to read it. So let me read it for you. And all the gopis are there, you know, the gopi groupies, like, oh gosh, I'm going to have bliss. I'm going to have bliss. I'm going to get bliss. I'm going to have, you know, lots of positivity. This is adventurous. This is so adventurous. This is so adventurous. And it's a slippery slope, that is, because we cannot say absolutely that's not helpful and adventurous, okay? But it's a very sketchy approach. It's a very unsafe approach. It's possible it can work for some who just can't have to have this derring do-ness in them. A rare occasion, it could work, okay? We're not saying it cannot. But I would say, by and large, for the vast majority of us, that is not the right approach to take at all. And, by the way, what do they get? Arrive at bliss? Well, we're going to arrive at the clear light perception. That's a higher, that's the highest, that's healed, true healed perception. That's, so, you know, they may ultimately work through the bliss and arrive there too, or they may not. But we're just going to kind of bypass the whole bliss thing and just arrive at the, you know, the full 360-degree ambience of pristine, clear light perception. And just an abidance in that. Abidance in it. Is it bliss? Is it, well, it's well, yes and no. Is it stillness? Yes. Is it the, so the stillness, etc., that is the bliss, but it's the pure bliss, it's the abidance, it's the clear light perception. So anyway, very interesting here, huh? It's very interesting just for me to hear this, what I'm saying. My willingness to share it to everyone, I end up saying stuff that I wouldn't hear myself say. Is better than just internal ruminations, actually, because I'm willing to help out. More comes out. How are we doing here? Pretty good. Oh, by the way, everything's going my way today. I was able to erase the video files on that memory card, which last night I just tried everything. I couldn't do it at all. I said, wow. And this morning, suddenly, I was able to erase all but one. I never can seem to erase all of them. It always leaves one. But I was able to get all the space that I have now. I have like 24 gigabytes of space here left. You know, so that's just fantastic, wonderful. Wonderful. It's a great day, the 21st of May. And I'm bringing back the continuity fear practice, which to me literally led me into clear light perception on several occasions, actually. That's how powerful it is. But then I said, wow, how do I abide in this? So I've been, you know, grounding myself more and more and more and more and more in towards abidance. And what really is, you can't get attracted out of abidance. This is what happens. And these fake adventure gurus, who are the bliss peddling gurus, they can attract you out of abidance if you're not careful. Because you have continuity fear, right, with abidance. And so they seem to offer some bliss without the continuity fear. Just come out of the abidance and we'll give you this, you know, blast of bliss. And you think, wow, it's tempting. They're very good temptresses and tempters and temptresses. This is the skill that arrogance has. It's arrogance. I call it the ugly face of arrogance, in that it is tempting you into believing that more arrogance is the answer. And that's the great danger, is it not? So we pray to Vajrayogini. Vajrayogini, we know that you have the means to totally put the whammy on this great dangerous temptation that is coming. So we give you full empowerment and permissions to put the whammy on this. Completely put the whammy on it. And we call upon you and the skillful means you have at your disposal to introduce those to us. Slam the door where arrogance dwells. Slam the door on that. This is like a specialized surgeon. A surgeon's like super specialized in like a really, really dangerous, tricky area. Where the other top surgeons say, oh wow, we have this really precarious situation. Call in this other surgeon. We know that they're gonna just nail this. They never fail on this one. Or as a courtesy, say, you know, we could do it, but why not let the one that can do it the best, let them come in and do it. It's a smooth way of dealing with it. It's a graceful, smooth way of dealing with it. So that it seems as though this Vajrayogini is that aspect of grace that knows how to slam the door on the allurement of this ugly face of arrogance trying to seduce us into the belief that more arrogance is the answer. And cutting our path off at bliss so then it can be rerouted, looped back. It's much easier to loop bliss back into concretization than it is to try and loop back stillness and peace. Once you reach stillness and peace and abidance in that, you're not likely to be looped back at all. It becomes almost, you know, virtually impossible. So they don't want that. So they're peddling bliss as much as possible. That's why they're peddling sex, drugs, and rock and roll as much as possible. That's arrogance that's doing that. See, we're not against bliss, but we have to put it in the right context. Absolutely. And our goal is to abidance so we cannot be looped back into arrogance at all. And bliss is not nearly as stable as peace. So our aim is peace, and we highlight that. And so already the Holy Spirit told me, you got to stop the media, stop the magazines, the television, the music, all this stuff. Music for the most part. Brad Soland, right side of the boat. His music's very nice. Now, it's not exciting. It's not bliss-inducing or anything. It's sort of peace-inducing, actually. It's not ambient. I mean, he's singing, and it's not designed New Age ambient sort of music, which also can help out towards peace. But it's... if I want to listen to a song, I'll listen to Brad Soland. I don't listen to much music now. I went back and looked at the Beach Boys and realized that's just positivity, yeah. But that may be a fire-breaking thing, actually, is to say, hey, I don't need your music, I have this. To keep me away from all the alluring bliss type of music that may be coming down the road. Plus, getting back into singing, the truth is I can sing better than what any music has to offer me. If I can get a song and just harmonize with it, that to me is better music than anything I can find musically. If I'm in practice, I enjoy it more. Let's put it this way. I wouldn't say, you know, technically people might say, ah, ha, ha, come on, what are you talking about? But I enjoy it more, which is what is crucial. So I can just take some honky-tonk song of George Jones and harmonize with it in such a way that it just like makes the song sound way better. Just like, wow, that's all I need. I don't need anything more sophisticated than that. So I can kind of provide my own music just through singing without even worrying about it, playing any instrument at all. Actually, it's way better. Singing is better than instrumentation, actually. Let me tell you this. This is now. I'm sort of a patron of musicians, okay? Patron of depression and musicians, drug problems, the whole ball wax, the sex, the drugs, the rock and roll, but patron of getting free from that. So I certainly can speak directly to musicians, any musician, anywhere. And I'll tell you this, that instrumentation is very problematical. And what you're trying to do, of course, is provide some bliss for yourself through the instrumentation. But it's way easier to do it vocally. So I was shifted off of instrumentation. Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma helped shift me off of that, actually. the grace of God, the Holy Spirit, and then using Sri Sri Anandamayi Maha, would maybe be Vajrayogini herself in some guy aspect, right? I mean, in multiple aspects in her case, but she actually shifted me off of instrumentation onto just singing. And this is vastly superior to instrumentation in terms of cutting through, getting right to immediate feedback of bliss without having to go through all of this effort. I mean, it's so difficult to stay in good enough shape instrumentally to produce that. It is so difficult. It's way easier to do it vocally. This is something the Holy Spirit pointed out to me long ago when I was like 20, 22 years old. I was very depressed. The Holy Spirit says, you got to start singing. I said, well, are you crazy? I can't sing. The Holy Spirit says, yes, you can. And I had a nervous breakdown at that point. It was one of the toughest experiences I've ever had in my life. And the Holy Spirit says, you got to sing. And I had a nervous breakdown. I couldn't do it. I was just shaking and trembling. I couldn't even talk. It was horrible. Because I realized I have to do this. And so I went out and got a cassette deck. Let's go back to this. We had cassette decks of Elvis Presley, his best hits. And I put that on a tape recorder. And I remember I just had the most extreme aversion to this. I just, it was like a phobia, a horrible phobia. Like, I'm going to sound hideous. I said, I'm going to sound so terrible. I'm never going to live this down. And I started singing. And I was shaking and trembling and sweating. It was horrible. But I started singing. I sang some more. I was just shocked. I said, what? I said, my voice sounds pretty good. I was just incredibly shocked by this. And so gradually, that was the first time I started singing. And from there, I started singing more and more and more. And I realized, like, wow, I actually can sing pretty well. This is very, very surprising to me. And so ultimately, this led to me just being aware of it, that I can sing. If, you know, I still was very much into instrumentalism. When, okay, my life was so caught up in music and instrumentalism that I was just obsessed by instrumentalism. I didn't really care about singing at all. I said, no, it's all about instrumentals, the instruments. And I'd practicing 10 hours a day on guitar. And before I practiced piano, keyboards, and whatever musical instrument there was, I would just practice it. That was just my whole life. And so gradually, I began getting away from that a little bit by bit by bit by bit by bit by bit. Finally, I was just down to like acoustic guitar and singing. And that's what I did. I'd go around singing. I took my acoustic guitar with whoever I'd go. I'd go out in nature and just sing. And it was just a company. I just accompanied myself on acoustic guitar and got rid of everything else, ultimately. And finally, I got rid of the acoustic guitars and I just listened to a song on a cassette player driving, and I'd just sing along with it. And I found that I could put my own unique creativity into the song and harmonize with it and just make the song sound great. Just fabulous. And I said, that's all I need. That gives me the music, this musical bliss that I'm looking for. I don't have to worry about instrumentation at all anymore. And so I can just hit it like boom, just like that. And I can get enough of it that it's enough. Whereas with instrumentation, it was never good enough. It was just hell. Because you just have to practice so much. And most of the time, you're stale. Instrumentally, you're rusty, and it's just very difficult. You have to be so committed to it. Whereas vocally, I found it was something I could do while driving. So I could do my practicing while driving, you see. In the Silicon Valley, you spend hours driving, you commute, or my job, I driving is my job. So I could just practice just driving, you see. Whereas you can't practice instrumentalism while driving. It's so much better. Singing is so much better than instrumentalism, spiritually, as far as helping you out and saving you time and effort and misery and all of that. So I stopped singing for, I've been having it sung for quite some time. And I was, Brad Soland inspired me to start singing again. I said, wow, I just feel like I just got to start doing this again. And right off the bat, I sounded great. Pretty amazing. Now, I got tired quickly. But I was right there, ready to, like riding a bicycle. And it's way easier to get back in shape singing than it is instrumentally. And if you're an instrumental musician, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Believe me, I've been there and done that. You get talking with someone who practiced 10 hours a day, year after year after year. You know, wanted to be a virtuoso. In a previous life, I was a virtuoso, instrumental virtuoso on the piano. So I know exactly what it's all about, down to the finest bit. And the shift from instrumentalism towards vocalism was the toughest shift I've ever made. I was so resistant to that. But something inside me says, you know what, this will save your life. If you don't do this, you're going to go into ruination in this life. And that was right. I was headed on a path to ruination for sure. I was on a path to thinking that instrumentalism was the only path to salvation there is. And I had to be some uber incredible virtuoso in order to do this. So, you know, I had to be Jimi Hendrix and Eddie Van Halen and, you know, all whatever it was. I had to be better than that. So I was willing to lose my life in an effort to do this. I was willing to starve. I was willing to just practice myself to death to achieve this. And of course, you know, and then you get into the drugs and you say, well, am I willing to, how far down the road am I willing to do that to achieve it? You know, if I'm tired, how much caffeine am I willing to take? You know, how much stimulation am I willing to do? You know, I have to be like better than Stevie Ray Vaughan, you know, like that. I heard Stevie Ray Vaughan, oh my God, you know, I got to be like this. I got to be better than this. Well, I mean, you know, that the way Stevie Ray Vaughan plays, that's going to destroy you. And it destroyed him for sure. He had to use heroin to cope with it. You know, that was scary. And Van Halen, too. I mean, but Eddie, you know, used mostly alcohol, but a lot of stuff. But alcohol, but Stevie Ray Vaughan, I mean, heroin. Jimi Hendrix, a lot of drugs. I mean, the Eric Clapton, heroin. So most of these virtuosos used drugs. It the path of instrumentalism is an extremely dangerous path. So, but Stevie Ray Vaughan, that scared the heck out of me. I got a Stevie Ray Vaughan Strat guitar. You know, I was trying to say, okay, I gotta play like Stevie Ray Vaughan. And I realized that the effort he put into it was gonna kill me. It's gonna kill me. There's no doubt about it. The life of a musician is a hard life. It kills you. Now, I'm not trying to be a musician. I'm just trying to, if there's a desire for bliss, I say I can just give it just by singing right here for just a quick hit, you know, that's enough. It's enough for me. So it's very helpful spiritually if you can do that. But instrumentalism, be very careful about that. I don't recommend it at all. I know if you're instrumentalist, you can be really upset about that. But just keep in mind what happened to me. I was an uber instrumentalist and the Holy Spirit said, you got to shift over to singing. And it saved my life. Absolutely saved my life, and the Vajrayogini worked with me on that for many, many, many years, very intensely. She says, try this Sankirtana. She attracted me to Sankirtana. I did that for a while and became very, very good at it. I could lead Sankirtana, actually. Absolutely, I could do that. I'm very good at it. If I get back into practice, I haven't done it for a long time. I was very good at it. But now I don't feel a need to be really good at it, right? You know, just enough. You don't need to excel at it, just enough, because bliss isn't the answer. It's peace that's the answer, ultimately. So again, instrumentalists, listen to this, hear this, and try just singing to a song on the radio and just say, I don't even think about playing chords or how am I going to play this and this is instrumentally. No, just drop it. Just drop it for a while. So I do not emphasize instrumentalism. In fact, I preclude it in the court of the Dharma King. I really preclude it. It's vocal. If there's any work, it's just vocal. Seriously, this is very serious, right down my alley. And having lived through the danger, endangerment of all this instrumentalism and stuff, yeah, this is something that I don't compromise on this. Sing a cappella if you need to. Or you can sing along to a record if you're driving in a car, a song, or sing along to a song in your vehicle. Now, what about wearing headphones and doing that? You can do that too. Make sure you sing though. Just don't listen. Sing. Very important. I don't listen to music. If I have music on, I'm singing along with it. Otherwise, I'm not listening to it. Very important. Don't become dependent. Prove to yourself you have the bliss within you. You have the capability for the bliss, for the creativity, for the sublime ineffableness. Prove to yourself you have it within you. Don't rely on some group to give it to you like that. Then you become dependent on it. It's very bad. And do it by yourself mostly, because if you're with someone who's a really strong singer, you'll feel like you'd be submerged or something like that. I don't feel any singer can submerge me. Not at all. But I don't try to prove the point. No. George Jones cannot submerge me. Brian Wilson cannot submerge me. But again, I don't go out of my way to prove it at all, because that's not the point of it all. The point of all is to prove yourself that you have the capacity for sublime bliss within you. But then also we're going to the peace, the ultimate peace. We're not denying bliss, in other words, but it's not our ultimate goal here. Cold day today, really. Very, like, almost winterish, May 21st. The weather's definitely changed. The people who live over the beach, they say there haven't been any fog for the last several years. No fog. I've never seen this. No fog at the beach. It's just extraordinary. All the starfish have died off. The kelp fields have disappeared because the starfish eat the sea urchins. The sea urchins eat the kelp. No starfish, the sea urchins explosion, population explodes, they eat all the sea kelp. Changes the entire ecosystem here. Because the water's so warm. A lot of change is happening, right? So we've gone over a lot of stuff here, haven't we? Yeah. Very super positive stuff. Full stop in the wow. Yes, I have a continuity problem, and it's a very severe problem, but it's the only problem I have. I don't have any other problems whatsoever. None. I don't have a world problem. I have a continuity problem. And shifting perception over to 360 degree pristine, clear, light perception, mental perception, clear light perception, abidance is the only cure there is for the only problem that I have. It's the only cure there is for the only problem that I have. It is the only cure there is for the only problem that I have. Reinforce this. Don't expect me to sing a song for you. You sing one for yourself. Prove to yourself you can do it. I'm not an entertainer. Prove to yourself you can do it. And you'll get better and better and better at it. At some point you say, if I need to entertain myself, I can sing with this great singer, and I can stand right up there on stage with him and sound out and just knock it out of the park. Just be devastatingly good. I'm getting back to it. It's coming fast. Yesterday I was fabulous at it. So it's coming back. I'm just not straining at it too much. Again, don't try to prove anything. Don't try to prove anything. Just prove it to yourself. Don't try to prove anything to anyone. Just prove it to yourself. Don't try to prove to some false guru that you can turn away from them. Just prove to yourself that you can turn away from them and just do it right now. Don't prove it to them. Don't prove it to them. Arrogance is a dangerous. Don't dance with it. Don't dance with arrogance. Don't even get near to dancing with it. It's very dangerous because we have this habit. We have the continuity fear, which tends to pull us back into the habits of thinking that more arrogance is the answer. And right now, it's women that are leading the charge to more arrogance. Very dangerous combination. It's the most dangerous combination of all. Because of our gentlemanliness, our gallantry, our love of mother, all this stuff, this is all rolled into one, where we tend to give them the benefit of the doubt, even if they're pushing more arrogance. This is it's a crisis for us. Obviously, well, I don't really want to be, too rejectful of that. I don't want to turn away from it. That's not, that's not nice. I want to be nice. And then we start getting, we're not adamant enough. We lose our focus. So that's where Vajra Yogini comes in. The founding principle say, hey, well, no, I don't worry. I can be adamant. I'll tell you how to be adamant about this. That body over there you think so attractive? Look at it now and just see that it's just absolutely just a bag full of this hideous pus. And the pus is just oozing out. Any attractive part of that body, you just see that pimples are arising and pus is oozing out of it. And seeping over the flesh. All this lovely velvet flesh, it's actually this terrible coagulated pus is seeping over it. Just look at it that way. No. See? So she's not being nice to the feminine form, is she? No, she isn't. But for us, it's tough to do that. We feel, that's not being nice. That's being so rude, and how rude. That's not a man. It's not supposed to be like that. Come on, but Vajrayogini is. Because she's all about protecting the Dharma, not protecting our arrogance. These false female gurus, or they open their mouth, what, just vomit comes out, just vomiting pus. Can't listen to anything they say. What you see is just they're vomiting pus everywhere. It's horrible pus. Just spraying out all over the whole audience. It's just spraying on you. Thank you, Vajrayogini, for that one. It's spraying. This pus is just spraying out of their mouths and it's spraying all over you. Puts the fear of God. Again, it's the most amazing thing. In Catholic Church, they had this little neat little helpfulness where they passed out fortune cookies that were really just these paper pieces of paper folded up like a fortune cookie, and you opened it up. They had tape on it. It was tape. You opened the tape up, and you opened it up. And on it, he says, I'm committed to the gifts of the Holy Spirit for this week. And my gift of the Holy Spirit is, and then they'd have what your gift was, and some might say it's charity, some might say it's joy, some, there's all these different gifts, and mine says the fear of God. And people are laughing at me. They say, what did you get? I said, fear of God. And they're laughing. He says, well, I said, that's a grace too. And I was kind of miffed. I said, what? I don't want to be afraid of God, but now I understand that I was graced by the fear of God.